Good morning, everyone, and thank you for coming. So, hopefully my presentation will come up. No? Yes, very good, thank you. And good morning, everyone. So let me begin by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land which we meet and pay my respects to their elders past and present. Defence Science and Technology Group has been supporting Australian Navy over many years. It's well known and acknowledged. So I guess that on that slide you can see two examples. Our work in contributing science and technology in the Collins-class submarine and the invention of the Nolka missile decoy. Just two examples, but two examples we're quite proud of, which have been really led to game-changing capabilities. Today I'd like to talk about the future. And it has to be, the future is also always shaped by the strategic environment. Clearly we've had the political and economic shifts from west to east, and the rise of China, the change of military engagement in Japan are just among some of the changes that we've seen in our region. But also the rapid technology change that is occurring. Technology now is, we've seen in the past, in certainly military systems, US defense and investments that were made there, the computer is invented based on investment in long-term R&D. GPS came from military investments, as has sensing and the internet. All came from military investments. However, the game is now actually changing in the sense now that industry is leading with technology developments and we're following. You can certainly see that in mobile computing and mobile telephony, satellite technologies. Industry is actually providing capabilities and doing it much quicker than we probably would have done under military development. So there's an opportunity now to be looking at commercial off-the-shelf systems of technologies which can be adapted. And so clearly with that advanced global access to such advanced technology, it means the threats of tomorrow are becoming much more agile. So it's very quick to assemble something. You can go down to literally buy off the shelf a UAV and configure it to fly, to conduct your own missions, or even make it into a form of improvised explosive device, a new form, very quick threat, which is not that easy to counter immediately. So these are things that we need to think about. And of course, the Australian Royal Navy needs access to world-class science and technology to maintain the capability edge that it has, and it needs to be always at the leading edge. So what is our support for this Royal Australian Navy? Clearly we operate in a number of areas. Firstly, we'd like to provide the strategic decision making to government and defence strategy, so import that you can do the analysis to make sure that we have the right force structure for our Navy going forward. What is the right strategic context that needs to be integrated into the white paper? So we make sure that we consider the threats, the operational concepts. So this then obviously then drive what areas of science and technology need to be invested in to make sure that we stay ahead of the game. So it's about the strategic context, then drives what force structure we need, then drives the S&T that is needed to realise that force structure. And that means how we can, and help in the next phase is, of course, once you've got the force structure, how do you achieve the operational goals by thinking about new operational concepts to meet new fleet requirements. For example, Australia now has a new amphibious capability. How do we actually support the operations of that capability? There are new ways that can be thought up. How do we simulate and make sure that that is absolutely the right or most optimal operational operating model? And using of wargaming to think about alternative ways to achieve strategic objectives, including this, the security environment. And of course, then there's the ongoing capability development. We all know that capability development is an ongoing thing. Once we have a platform, the platform may be in service for 20, 30 years, and technology will be evolving in the meantime. So we need to think about how we spiral development in the latest technologies into this to meet the future requirements of the future. We, for instance, are continually looking ahead. So my organisation produces a report like a foresighting report saying forward 2035. We're thinking about what will be the environment like in 2035. So that then casts back to say what should we be thinking about how to get to that environment in 2035. What are the technology steps or plateaus that we need to scale to get there? And of course, the other important point is to keep thinking about what are going to be the game-changing technologies. For example, we've been considering and studying and investing in hypersonics. Hypersonics, when you can a platform can fly at Mach 6, Mach 8, well, that certainly defeats just about any air defence system. That's a game changer. How do we make sure that we're ready to adopt that technology and also at the same time assess its threat, because someone else may develop such technology? Well, how will that affect our own platforms? And these areas, there's numerous areas. Electronic warfare is one area which will be a continuing change of environment. Cyber. And also, you know, the countering weapons of mass destruction, be it chemical, and space, and even asymmetric threats that I talked about previously. So what are the key areas where S&T, we're looking to invest in or support the Australian, Royal Australian Navy? And these are in areas such as decision superiority, undersea warfare, the survivability of the mission, joint operations, the power and energy question, and of course seaworthiness and airworthiness of the fleet. So these are the sort of the topics, these six topic areas I'd like to discuss in the rest of my talk. And but that's the oversight. So I'll now go through each one of those and give you a bit of the highlights around that. So what is the purpose of defence superiority? Well, decision superiority. And that's about being able to make the informed and accurate decisions in real time. And that's critical to successful maritime engagement. But we all know that the decision cycle is rapidly shortening. And and we've got the challenge, the information systems that we rely on are becoming exposed to degradation or attack. In fact, when we think about it, increasingly, all our information systems will be dependent on cyber. So if someone was to interfere with our systems, we could very easily get our superiority decision-making of integrating all this information or the dependence on it actually makes you vulnerable. So the cyber threats will be game-changing. And so we must understand them, actually how to use those cyber technologies ourselves, but also be aware of how our own situation can change. So it's this cyber has become a, you know, a game changer in terms of enhancing our own capabilities and being able to integrate many sources of information to get a better situational awareness, but it also creates a vulnerability. But also this information integration and expected interoperability makes it an opportunity and a challenge. And ultimately, it's all about getting the right information to the right person in the right time frame to make the right decision. That's what we're seeking to do. So what are the technologies that need to go with this? So what are we looking to do in my organisation to support a decision superiority? So certainly, we're now looking at advanced computing, optical and quantum computing. These technologies are probably on that 10 to 20 year horizon. So certainly in the 2020s, we expect to see quantum computing coming of age. Now, quantum computing is a game changer potentially. Certainly from the cryptographic point of views, they can be able to defeat most systems. Although we can now develop new systems, which we're anticipating quantum computing, we're already working on algorithms which aren't prone to this type of reverse engineering or cracking of the codes. So that's important. However, quantum computing does offer the very high potential to do a lot of calculations in short times or solve complex problems. So basically, you may have computers which are very advanced but in very small footprints. So which means you can do a lot more onboard computing on a platform. Opens up a whole new paradigm in terms of being able to run things. And of course, we are, because of the cyber threat, we need to think about how to protect ourselves or harden our systems against cyber and EW attacks. Particularly, you know, we all have greater reliance on SATCOM. If SATCOM was disrupted, it would actually make the operations much more difficult. And we need to think about these things and anticipate these things. So that means we need to have dynamic communication networks, networks that can reconfigure themselves. Maybe a radar can become a communication system and be able to communicate at shorter distances to other platforms who could then actually pass on the information. These are the sort of things that are possible, and we need to be thinking about these things. And ultimately, with the rise of machines and big data, we need to be able to sort through the data. You cannot really rely on a single operator just integrating all the information on their screen. They will have information overload. So we are looking to see that smart networks or smart machines doing the data processing and then filtering out the 80% of the data which is clearly not of relevance or importance in this context, and only presenting the data that's actually relevant to the operator at that particular time. So that requires machines to be able to reason about the tasks that's required, the threats, and what's required in that context. So it's machine intelligence. And as I talked about before, being able to reconfigure networks as platforms join or dynamically come into operations. And of course, using of the electromagnetic spectrum is becoming more crowded and advanced, and people can listen in to your use of that spectrum and understand what your context is, or even disrupt you. So in fact, it may now be, we should be thinking about systems which are passive. So you all know about sonar systems which are, you know, pulse out a sonar beam and then wait for the echoes. We can actually now be using the background information to passively sense, and that the technology is now getting to the point where you don't really need to be pulsing with active sonar, but actually just listening. And by listening, you can actually gain a lot of situational awareness without actually revealing that you're actually out there searching. So these are important technologies. Now, of course, passive technology has enormous amounts of data it'll pick up, so it has to be then filtered and then integrated back. So the information management aspects is very important to this. And I'm conscious of the time. I need to move along. So undersea warfare. This is actually a key aspect. And this is driven by the need for assured access to the underwater and littoral environments by submarines and other platforms. But this can only be assured if the platform is able to sense and predict the relevant properties of the ocean environment. So in other words, knowing where to go and how to do this. And that means you must have better sensing, real-time sensing systems, and advanced data processing to actually understand the changing environmental picture. And by understanding the environmental picture, the platform can exploit the changes in the environment and adapt to the changing conditions. For example, the knowledge of change in duct tide will enable a submarine to exploit this and hide and move as the duct changes. So this ability to detect threat requires another group of advanced sensors that provide high-resolution picture of the threat system. The display you see here is an interesting one in the sense that it's an overlay of environmental prediction. So there's a model understanding what you should be seeing, and then over the top is overlaid the actual sensing models. And then you can actually see if there's discrepancies, because quite often it's very hard to navigate or understand what you're expecting to see and what you're actually seeing, and then the human can actually process the difference and understand that. So this is an important area of technology, particularly if you're using unmanned platforms like the glider you see in the top. That's one of our own technologies being deployed. It actually gathers information, and you want to understand, well, you don't actually know where it is because it's deployed, but it'll actually be mapping against the targets and being able to overlay what's expected with what is actually being detected. And moving along. So one of the areas that we've obviously are interested in undersea warfare is the development of long-range sensors which can detect, classify, locate, and track threat submarines. So this will include the development of advanced acoustic sensors, both fixed and relocatable seabed arrays. Advanced superconducting magnetic sensors, which are both airborne or space-based, as well as multi-static coherent sonar buoy fields, as well as electro-optical radar sensors. So these are the areas that we've been working in. Certainly we've developed a fibre optic laser seabed acoustic sensors, which are now deployed. And And particularly, we've also worked very closely with other science agencies like the CSIRO and the Bureau of Meteorology to improve our undersea environment modelling and simulation predictions. And we've put these developed superior operational tools for our warships. So you can see actually the model here is actually showing the depth of the mixed surface layer or the surface duct of the ocean off New South Wales coast. And this was work done with the Blue Rink ocean maps data, working with the CSIRO and the Navy. So the depth of the surface duct critically affects hull-mounted sonar performance. By knowing what the state of the ocean or predicted state, you can actually optimise the operational use of your sonars when you're there. So this is, again, game-changing technologies. And there you see the photograph up the top shows our fibre laser hydrophone array, which has been deployed at sea. Now, when you deploy these sort of systems, and particularly if you use autonomous systems, they'll have to, you have the data, but you have to actually process the data. And data processing has become a challenge. And that's why you have to have these algorithms, which is called machine learning, where the machine actually accumulates enough data to understand a pattern. And then you can actually classify the pattern to say it's this particular target or not. And rather than rely on humans doing this, because the data now, we are moved into a big data world, which is providing data that operators cannot process, so we really require machines and robots and cognitive learning to occur. And of course, then fusing multiple sensors, if you get data from one particular acoustic array, say sitting on the seabed, plus other data from a submarine, how do you actually integrate that information? And what we're seeing is, rather than the platform sitting on their own, being able to share the data about undersea warfare situations to get a better situational analysis. Moving on, mission survivability. So, of course, this is important in a threat environment, particularly when the threat environment is evolving. And so this will require, obviously, evolution of advanced threats require new technologies. You could imagine that advanced threat, you could imagine, could be something like swarming technologies, multiple UAVs or multiple surface vehicles, base vessels going at a target. That can actually change the game considerably. So we need to be thinking about how do you counter these sort of things and develop improved weapon systems. And of course, one of the other important points is recovery from damage or recovery of platforms after damage. So platform self-defense and self-protection is quite an important area, and these are areas that we are investigating new technologies. And firstly, from the protection low observables, so making sure that with right material science and design of vessels or platforms, you can actually have a low observability. And of course, other people are doing the same thing. So how do you actually counter other people's low observables and still be able to observe them? So you need better sensing technologies. And of course, the high speed threat detection, which is now emerging and will continue. That means we need better advanced weapon systems, and also electromagnetic technologies potentially. For instance, for swarming technologies with multiple USVs coming, you could actually use electromagnetic pulse, and we've investigated that, quite possible and deployable. And of course, because at times these responses are at so high speed, you have to have an automated response. The system has to respond in its own way. Yes, I can see smiles here. But and of course, there's the recovery. But also, there's also particularly you need these automatic systems in cyber attacks, because when a cyber attack occurs, it occurs at multiple fronts, and you have to have a system which is ready to detect and respond. One of the other areas that's clearly for Australian Defence Force is joint and combined operations. And under Plan Polaris, by 2018, the Navy will generate and deploy a self-supported, sustainable maritime task force capable of accomplishing the full range of maritime security operations. And these are, across all the various platforms. So it's quite a bold plan to move forward in this area. So this, and particularly integrating all our platforms such as the LHD, which require, of course, integrated and networked capabilities. And we've been looking at how to develop tools to allow air warfare coverage zones. And in fact, you can see there from two of our FFGs. All right, moving on. What are we doing here? So our work is, again, improving operations research analysis to truly understand all the varieties of operations that could occur, understanding the modelling tactics, the game, wargaming these, and then following this up with hard experimentation and field trials to understand whether these are the right tactics, the right areas, and right ways to conduct joint operations. And then thinking about, when you have these joint operations, how do you integrate unmanned and autonomous systems into these? How do they play into the whole concept? And maybe there are other parts of the task force which will not actually be controlling the unmanned platform, but we'll need access to that data or understand the context in which it's operating. So it becomes quite complicated. And of course, then there's the information that comes off all these various platforms. How do you share it and analyze it and fuse it and then ultimately guide decision making? And look, this is an image, it's not ours, it's actually a courtesy of the US Space and Naval War Systems Command, and it shows a variety of US platforms working together to detect and defeat enemy submarines. Now, Australia's in the process of procuring many of the platforms that are shown in this image, for example, the P-8 Poseidon and the MH-60R. These platforms are performing the anti-submarine warfare role. Now, the question is, for Australia, is how do these systems fit into our Navy, Army and Air Force platforms and operations? What is our picture? We don't have one yet. And so we're putting people onto our operational analysis experts who've used their in-depth knowledge of individual platforms to help determine how we'll operate our platforms and systems to meet our own unique operational requirements. And our teams are now working on our combined Air Force and Navy anti-submarine warfare picture. So that's the next stage. We should be working towards this, and that's one of our goals of our work. Now, power and energy. Clearly, this is a key enabler, and without it, you can't do things. But it's also a key. It's a limiter. It's insufficient power. It limits the range of, say, UAVs. Or other autonomous platforms. And it also has many aspects of impacts of a platform, such as its speed, as I said, its endurance, its signatures, weight, stability, use of advanced weapon systems, such as directed energy or phased array radars. These are very power-hungry types of technologies. And, of course, then there's the reliability that goes with the power and energy systems and the maintenance and through-life costs, all very important. So, and we need to also think about how we can make these systems increasingly more portable and also thinking about how we can store energy. These are key challenges. So what are we doing in this area? So we are looking at more energy efficient technologies. In fact, here at this conference yesterday, we launched a joint project with Siemens and QUT on developing high temperature superconducting technologies, which will essentially halve the weight of power distribution systems and also at the same time increase the amperage or the current that can be handled by such systems. This is the future. And of course we have to think about how to harvest new commercial technologies which are coming out in energy management. As I said earlier, the commercial sector is moving in leaps and bounds in the power and energy management areas. And of course, thermal management. These are important things, how to minimize that, but also thinking about thermal systems. How can you harvest energy from a thermal system? And there are now potentials now with new technologies which actually potentially harvest up to 20% of the waste energy that's coming out of a thermal system. Fantastic work. And of course, thinking about hybrid power systems using renewables, fuel cells, biofuels. And of course, we want power for new weapons technologies, such as rail guns. I mean, they can fire projectiles at speeds of Mach 5 or higher. And in the US, the US Navy actually demonstrated its electromagnetic rail gun. And it was at moving, the projectile moved at Mach 7, hitting targets 175 kilometres away, but enormous consumer of energy. And so you, how do you power such a thing and be able to, it's great to have such a technology, but you've got to think about how to keep it moving. Moving along, I'm just conscious of the time. Seaworthiness and airworthiness of the fleet. These are very operationally important for a maritime capability to deliver the operational outcomes. So you have to be obviously seaworthy and airworthy, but it's also you have to think about the safety of the platform, the crew, and these days increasingly environmental protection is a requirement. And we have to address, obviously this has to all be done in an affordable way. So what are we sort of doing in these areas? Clearly, structural integrity and service life extension. This is something the Australian Defence Force does quite often. We work on our platforms to extend their lives. One of the things we've become very interested in, and we've been instrumenting our platforms, such as the Armidale-class patrol boats, two of them, with sensors to monitor the hull and the stress on the hull to understand when maintenance is to be done or how to actually preserve and make sure that the hull, because it ultimately, when the hull is fatigued, that's it. That's the end of the. It's pretty hard to do life extension on a fatigued hull. So understanding the state of the hull, then it means you can start to do what we call condition based maintenance rather than service based or time based maintenance and repairs. So these are important methodologies and techniques that we've been looking at, and in fact, we are now developing these modelling and simulation tools that accurately modelling as designed, as built, as repaired, and as deteriorated structures. So you can actually maintain, look, get a whole throughput on the whole system. And that will actually allow you to guarantee or better manage seaworthiness and, of course, airworthiness as well. And, of course, it's the human-machine interface and people in the loop are maintaining these areas. Operator fatigue. We've done a lot of studies into sleep, and you probably may have seen something in the last week about caffeine and keeping you alert in tasks. And, of course, you have to do all these type of work in an environmentally acceptable way. I mean, the compliance requires compliant emissions from propulsion systems and materials, such as paint and biofouling coats. Now, although much of this technology exists and is used on naval platforms, we still see an increased environmental legislation will drive technology to develop new solutions. And, of course, as I said before, it's going to be a big data problem in this area, because as if you imagine that every ship is instrumented with sensors to actually understand its true condition, what do you do with that data? You've got to actually ship it back to where it can be analysed and then decide when parts need to be changed or serviced appropriately. Now, to do all this type of work for you in the Navy, you really need science and technology, which is really world class. And I've got to say, we've recently had some reviews of the DST group, and you do have world class capabilities, some of it the best in the world. Certainly our undersea warfare non-acoustic signature work is world class, the best of breed. So we are trying to focus on where we have unique domain knowledge, and we've actually do this work in a way where we retain the sovereign capability for our nation, right? Because it can't be provided by other countries or gives us a technical edge, such as signature management. You wouldn't want to get anyone else to do that for you. Okay, so, and to do this, we still need partnerships with universities and industry, and this week here at Seapower Conference, we've been celebrating some of our alliances with industry, and it's all about building capacity, and we certainly also leverage the Five Eyes for us in cooperation to share the burden in sharing facilities. We operate some facilities that other Five Eyes don't have and vice versa. So it allows us not to duplicate on infrastructure, but allows us to leverage infrastructure and be able to drive us forward. So I'm about to wrap up. So thank you. And look, I think that you'll see that the future Navy will be technology-driven. And these new technologies will give us new platforms and new systems and new ways of thinking about how to conduct the work. So thank you very much. I'm over time, so I'll wrap it up there. Thank you very much.
Good morning. I'm very pleased to be here. And my topic is operational impact of the new technologies on naval warfare. My focus is really on high-intensity conventional war, not operation shorter war, like combating terrorism, combating piracy, and so on, even though certain technology has effect because the same patterns are used also for the operation of shorter war. I divided my presentation three main parts. One is deals with general, the role and importance of technology on naval warfare, and then the impact of the new technologies on the fundamental warfare areas like ASW, anti-surface warfare, and then finally on information and how the information affects the warfare as a whole. So because of the short time, I will only summarize current technological advances and then focus mostly on interpretation of that, okay? So that you know that I cannot just simply, there's simply not time to cover everything, okay? And I'm not a designer, I'm not an architect, I'm a historian and deal with some, you know, aspects of the operational art, you know, in war at sea. Let me start here. I start always with some quotes that a famous writer who wrote a very, very respected book on the psychology of the mass movements, Hofer. And I don't agree completely with that because we need to think about future technologies impact because that has a major impact on writing the doctrine and also development naval theory. Okay, so we professionals, we cannot simply, you know, and I will not call this obsession, it is a necessity, okay? And then I think I will agree with Admiral Mahan that all what we can do is really provide some general statements, you know, because really nobody knows what future we bring. I would only say that in terms of technology, it's probably task is easier because many things are already firmly trend is known. And many things which are already either under the development or drawing boards, we already know. And I would say also that we cannot, certainly we have to avoid most optimistic predictions and avoid most pessimistic. And I would say we probably can go 5 to 7 years ahead of time, but not really looking too much into the future. As you know, the future or vision of future war is also affected by the various political, diplomatic, economic, and sometimes psychological effects, and that might also affect the, how we view technology. So it's not all completely just a question of materiel, okay? So it affects naval art, I would call military art, okay? It affects strategy, and not to great extent as the operational art and tactics, okay? So the greatest impact of the technology is always on a tactical level, then less so at the operational level, and then also strategy, but affects all the components of the naval art. And then it has also character of war at sea, and I will mention this a little bit more in detail. Then naval theory and naval doctrine. As you know, naval theory has two main components. One is historic, because we try to deduce lessons learned or identified from the past, and we also have to look vision of the future war. So we cannot have an imbalance. We cannot be totally historic and totally technological. That's always proper balance must be found, okay? The same thing when you write an operational level doctrine, it must include always future vision of the war, because that also affects the force planning, in which way, what Navy you want to see, what composition, things like that, okay? And then you have certain methods of combat force employment, and then naval force planning, as I said, naval education training. So it has effect really throughout the almost entire, spectrum, what we do, okay? I don't know, the operational art is not well understood by the naval forces, for navies generally, in my judgment, is much focuses on tactics and strategy. And that part is not well understood. I think, I would just say that that's an area which deals with the planning, preparing, conducting, sustaining major naval operations and maritime littoral campaigns. That's what operational art is. It is the linkage between tactics and strategy. The gap between tactics and strategy is too large to be covered, by tactical actions only, okay? And I think that's navies always, because the navies are platform-centric, there's too much focus on the tactical side and neglected the operational level, okay? But when you're a fleet commander, or you're a theater commander, you always have to think operationally versus tactically, okay? And this is, as you know, we used always term character and nature of war. Character of war is this one way of defining, okay? It is transitory, it is always affected many elements, and in contrast to nature of war, as Karl von Clausewitz, very famous Prussian theoretician, taught us, you know, that nature of war is timeless. It is these are constants in any war. That means primacy of policy, the hatred, violence, luck, chance, fog of war, friction. All these things are always present in any conflict, you know. And in terms of character, these are the main components which affects the character of war. Now, the technology always, the science always had a major impact on the character of war, but not exclusively, because you have also demography. You have also radical changes in the security environment. For example, the end of the Napoleonic Wars, World War I, World War II, collapse of communism, now rise of China. All these things, you know, affects the character of war. And you have also, in terms of Navy, the land warfare. That means you cannot, you know, develop vision of the war without regard how the character of war on land is, because the naval air forces should always be supporting the army. Outcome of any war is always on land. That's where the people live, humans live. That means that's the most important thing, okay? And there are some pitfalls. Overemphasizing technology, and I was sort of exaggerating importance of new naval technologies, okay? And I have some, naval doctrine. These are, for example, French Young School, which was dominant in 1880s, to the end of the 19th century, was exclusively based on technology. And that's one of the pitfalls. The network setting warfare, effects-based planning. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's all based on technology. I think that's a basic flaw of all these new theories. You know, and we have to be careful not to emphasize or overemphasize the technology in developing new doctrines. You know. And then, you know, I think that because of the overemphasis in technology, too much focus is on tactics or weapons, systems, sensors, platforms, and neglect of the combined arms tactics. That means the surface forces, submarines, air, and also branches of combat arms or other services, you know. And then also is the neglect of tactical versus operational thinking. And I would say also neglect of the human factor. I'm not singling out any Navy, but there is a tendency to somehow overemphasize, and in that, you know, even though we know all of that we are humans, you know, we should never neglect that, you know, the technology is a servant. It is not a master. Okay, I think that's sometimes very often forgotten. Okay, so if you read the history, the advent of mines, torpedoes, aircraft, submarines always went to, you know, lend to exaggerations, okay? That doesn't mean that these events were not revolutionary and radical changes, but they were not as proponents thought that this is the end of the, you know, warfare as we knew it, okay? So whenever we develop something, we have to be very careful that not all advances are revolutionary. When you look history of the naval warfare, there were very few advances like advent of steam, you know, the internal combustion engine, wireless radio, things like that. But then most of the developments were evolutionary, and the new quality was actually brought by proper integration of the existing technologies. One of the great examples is Dreadnought in 1906. Which overnight made all the battleships obsolete. But none of these technologies were new. They were all existing, but they were properly integrated, you know. And today we have information technologies, which are also a result of steady evolution and not very few radical changes, you know. That's the reason I have a problem with this term of disruptive technologies, things like that, you know, okay. And then we have, you know, in the heyday of the transformation in the United States and also elsewhere, there was a great emphasis given that information can't replace the numbers, that information is such a powerful factor that we can safely reduce the size of the fleet and things like that. I think these are things, in my judgment, wrong, because you cannot be at two places at the same time. You still need certain numbers. And going down, in the size of fleet has many negative effects, you know. And I think we have also, unmanned vehicles. If you all know, I'm not saying that unmanned vehicles are not necessary, that certainly we should develop them, but we should be careful not to overemphasize the use of the unmanned vehicles as a replacement for everything what we know today. Okay, so I'm trying somehow somehow be more skeptical than to be too over enthusiastic about these things. Okay, and this is, I want to explain the difference between tactical impact and operational impact. When I wrote this paper, really I cannot go straight to the operational impact. I had to think about tactical impact, means how that affects the employment of the single combat arms, the single platforms, and then go to how that affects the employment of the combined arms, two or more combat arms, in warfare at sea. So that's a difference between operational and tactical. And I think, unfortunately, we have too much emphasis on tactical impact of the new technologies versus operational. But we need both, as you know. Tactics is basis everything. If you are not a good tactician, you cannot have possibly be a good operational artist. Okay, so I'm not claiming everything is strategy, operational art, and tactics you can just neglect. No, tactics is foundational everything. Okay, so I have only summaries of the various strengths. You all know these things, okay? And I will just comment here, I agree with Admiral Mahan. This trend, toward multi-mission ships has many advantages, but has many disadvantages. I would argue that you increase efficiency by having multi-mission platforms, but you also probably lose a lot of military effectiveness. There is a difference between effectiveness and efficiency, okay? We all know that dual purpose or single purpose is much always better in terms of the effectiveness than when you have a multi-mission platforms. Okay. Then we have results. We have especially in big navies, highly capable, large platforms. But when you put large platforms, a lot of your combat potential is in these platforms. So if you lose them, you lose big part of your potential. So there is a downside to that. Okay. And I think that's operational impact. There are some negative things, okay? Okay. And I think that's what is forgotten, that in the war at sea, when you have to fight for sea control, and obtaining sea control, you need much larger, much more powerful platforms. But when you need to maintain the platform after that objective is achieved, you should need different platforms. You need the smaller ships in many numbers, and you also need smaller ships in maritime trade protection and defense. We have now a view, as you know, widely spread, there will be no war in sea, there will be no war against maritime trade. And that goes against any logic, in my judgment, no history. There is no any war or protracted war in history where national interests were at stake. There was no war against maritime trade. And this fact that we are now globalized, that we are so interconnected, that was the case in 1914. And if you read the book by Norman Engel, the British, he wrote Optical Illusion. And he predicted there will be no wars. The wars are counterproductive. He wrote that book in 1909. And after that, we have a two world conflicts, okay? Okay. So we say that the smaller navy you have, the more important is to use these resources properly. And that's what operational art is so critical. Okay, even when you have a large navy, sometimes that you can squander your numerical superiority by being overly tactical. Okay, but when you have a small navy, and especially in the smaller navies, operational art, importance of operational art is much more increased. Anti-surface warfare, I have some of the summary. I consider this new development in anti-ship ballistic missiles potentially revolutionary if they work, okay? You know all these things here, okay? I think there is a great, certainly progress made and great potential in directed energy weapons, okay? And that this, I think, the problem of the ASBM, I think probably countered by the offensive information warfare, the ballistic missile defense. And I think that one of the negative effect can be actually that might force the other side into preemptive attack. Okay, so that's also a downside of these new developments, you know, for the side which is developing ASBM. Okay, these are not just, you know, things without any consequence, you know. And I would say in terms of directed, especially directed energy weapons and so on, there is a greater protection for those large surface combatants, you know, but certainly there is a potential for the much more offensive use of the DEW. And I think that in terms of methods of combat force employment, strikes will probably emerge as much more important than naval battles. Probably naval battles are think of the past, that's in my view, okay? As a result of all these new developments in terms of missiles, you know, and the heavyweight torpedoes and so on, okay? Because, you know, when you look at methods of combat force employment, naval tactical actions, major operation campaigns, they're all result of long historical evolution. And the major impact on the methods always had technology. Okay. Anti-submarine warfare, these are some of the summaries of the new developments. I will not read them. Okay. 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 And there are some claims, you know, without naming names, that people think that what they call kill chain can be so speeded up that you essentially can make ASW very fast, you know, and very, very easy to resolve, you know, which I don't believe that is actually true, okay. And these are some operational impact, okay. I think we have problem in littorals, you know, in the past, during the Cold War, we have very good theater-wide social system, for example, and so on, very reliable, but now we lack actually data for littorals, you know. Littorals are always a problem, you know. Okay. And will always require, you know, joint employment, plus employment of other forces, plus the participation of the government, non-government agencies, and scientific community. And I would say the ASW will still remain as attrition warfare, force-on-force warfare. There will be no, how I see it, you know, any major, short or maybe some breakthrough in non-acoustic detection, okay. Amphibious warfare, as you know, there are a lot of views in the United States because of the anti-access and area denial capabilities that there's a great deal of debate, and some people think that these amphibious assaults are essentially things of the past. That's, again, ahistorical. Sea power must always go ashore. Since the invasion of Greece, 480, you know, by Persians, the amphibious assaults were always conducted, and what changes the methods? So we've had to find a new method how to overcome these difficulties, but it doesn't mean that amphibious landings are think of the past, okay? Okay. And so there are some new concepts, you know, in U.S. Marine Corps, operation manual from the sea, and that's an operational level, and a storm that's a short to, you know, movement. Okay, that's a tactical, and plus sea basing. Okay. So I think that's what might happen, okay, in the future. Again, my views, these are not views, you know, I really don't know, okay? So I might look like I know, but I really don't know. This is just, okay. But I will tell you, that this was one prediction by the Chairman Joint Chief of Staff, Omar Bradley, in 1949. And what happened 15 September 1950, Operation Chromite at Incheon, where we landed 70,000 troops 150 miles behind the lines of Busan perimeter. So what I'm saying that many of these predictions, people should be very careful, you know, okay? And I think that's one reason history is so important. Not that history tells us what will happen, but will make you humble, that you should avoid some of these categorical statements, you know, okay? Okay, that's a current that operation maneuver from the sea concept, okay? And problem, as you know, is how to overcome the beach defenses, you know. Mine warfare, okay. So these are some of the advances, as you know. I cannot fit them all on one slide. Okay, there are many, okay. Okay, and so this operational impact thing, we still remain force on force, is attrition warfare. It will take much more effort and time as it was in the past. We still have a problem of the defeating mines in the between 0 and 10 meters, you know, okay? And I think that I'm not against organic MCM, but you really should have all these triads, you know, surface mine MCM or MCM vessels, the underwater MCM and the airborne all together. There should not be really sacrificing one over another, okay? And I think that's also too tactical view of the MCM. It should be operational view. That means the theater-wide mine countermeasures. And I would also argue that probably the best way to defeat new mines is to conduct offensive MCM. That means destroying the MCM, the mine production facility, research facilities, and so on. And you need for that very good intelligence, as you know, okay? As I always say, it should not be an overuse and over-reliance. Again, this is not a call. We don't need unmanned vehicles. Always to, you know, no technology can replace human brain, the judgment, and the experience. Machine is as smart as you program, okay? And I have technologies, and I don't know whether we have time, you have 5 minutes, you know. I would say the information technology really affects all aspects of operational art. There is not a single one that is not affected, okay? And I'm not saying that information warfare is not something new. It is new, even though all wars were fought for information. But it's a new quality today, and nobody, you know, I think what I always argue, we should not overemphasize things and going too much into extreme, you know. In terms of these are some of the possible developments in the next 10, 20 years, you know, that's based on U.S. Views. I don't know how accurate, I have no knowledge or certainly internal knowledge or anything, okay? Okay, so these are some of the things which might happen, okay? As you know, we use term space-time force, but Germans use term operative factor and operational factors, you know, when we talk about operational art. And there are some views which people think that information should be added as a new factor, but I think there's another group which thinks that is not realistic because the quality, the volume, you know, relevancy and framework or information cannot be controlled. So what we say is that, what I say is that information affects each of these factors, but is not really in the same. Why reason? Why when space-time force, when you determine objective, you have to calculate, you have to evaluate each factor against objective. And then if you have a major imbalance, you have to either scale down the objective or extend the timeline, things like that. That's what we call balancing or harmonizing space-time force versus objective. And you cannot simply do this without information, okay? Okay. So this is one, I think, in terms of the objectives, operational strategic, in a struggle for sea control, I think this is something which naval classical thinkers never certainly thought. In today's era, you really need information dominance, not as a technology, but the information dominance, because you need this both for sea control and sea denial. And very often, I think, especially in the West, information warfare is somehow considered as a separate completely and not really linked to the support of major naval operations and campaigns. And I would argue if you read, which I read, English translation of the Chinese textbook, Science of Campaign, which is essentially operational art, they really try to integrate offensive-defensive information warfare in every operation, whether it's a single service or joint. I don't know how, you know, effective that will be, but I think that's a very good approach that you need to integrate your plans and execution, the information dominance, you know. Okay, space-time force. I would say this, okay, in terms of factor of space, the cyberspace, you know about factor of time, and I will probably end here, okay. factor of force, I think that one thing which we change is really the that I consider that that is, as I mentioned earlier, that information will replace the numbers, you know, so I think that's really not based on either logic or experience. You know, I think we have to be very careful not to go overboard with it, okay? I think what we change, we already have this, you know, the any Navy which relies extensively on networking, and I'm not saying that we should not do it, that's also now new change, the center of gravity, that means the source of power which prevents you or allows you to achieve objective, you know, is really computer networks. So, but computer networks have their lack inherently the attributes of defense because they don't have fires and maneuver, you know, and they're also difficult to protect, okay? But I think it is a one very new development. Another development is also deception. You know, deception has been always used throughout the history of the 3,500 years of warfare. I think what is now new, you know, the new methods are really by using information technologies in lieu of the forces. We don't have extra forces which we can assign for deception. But another new development that the weaker side has also much more now greater opportunity to deceive you than they were in the past, okay? So I will end here because I run out of time, okay? Okay, but the information really that has effects on, I didn't really know with, you know, with every aspect of the operational art. There is no one single one that is not affected, you know. Okay, so I'm done, okay, thanks.
Well, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Commodore Kath Richards, and I'm the Director General of Engineering for the Royal Australian Navy. And it was just a delight to hear our presenters, Dr. Alex Zielinski and Dr. Milan Vigo there, talk about the role of technological influences and sea power. But now, ladies and gentlemen, it's your turn. So could I ask you, please, if you have a question, to raise your hand, and that will give time for our team to come over and identify you. And then if you could tell us what your name is and the organisation that you work with. Let's have those questions now for our panel. So, over to you. Don't be shy. Yes, over in the corner here, please.
Good morning, ma'am. Commander Simon Brown, Royal Australian Navy. I'd like to direct my question to Dr. Zielinski, if I may, please.
Yes.
You kind of rushed through your brief pretty quickly because there's a lot of technologies out there that need to be looked at or considered. I was just wondering if there's actually a process or a trigger or something that we need to consider when looking at the vast number of technologies that are coming basically onto the market every day, so that we don't miss something or spend lots of dollars running down a rabbit hole because it looked good at the time.
Okay, that's a good question. So I think the question is for any program, we've certainly in the maritime space, we've now developed a maritime S&T plan, which is kind of taking the view of what are the driving forces that we need to consider, but also understanding the operational and strategic needs of the Navy. So it's actually done at a 2-star, 3-star level, and as well as also at any particular time, we're also engaging with the Navy to ask, what are your problems? What are your challenges to day-to-day? And out of that, we construct probably a portfolio of projects which have got three horizons. Yeah, something you're going to deliver in the next 12 to 18 months, something which is on a say 2 to 3 year horizon, and other things which are on a 5+. And what we need to do is you review the portfolio every year. So, and then you just move it around. So it's no different to if I said to you, like, how do you manage a property portfolio? You know, how much money do you put into, say, vacant land versus buying houses versus office blocks, industrial sites? That's what companies, you know, manage a property portfolio. And not to be caught out by, you know, trends. So you can't leave a property portfolio static, nor can you leave a science and technology portfolio static. So really, what we try to do is construct something which is done in that way. You continually also do emerging technology scanning to actually see that what's happening. Also, run workshops with your, you know, with the Navy, and just think about what are the operational needs that are continually doing that. Also, collaborate internationally to understand what others are doing, and also scanning the literature. So you have to rely on, and if you've got a very well skilled workforce in the S&T background, they are doing that kind of. So the idea is to have those discussions and talk about the business of defence, and then review the plans on an annual basis, but also think big picture down to also operational aspects, because we're here also to, when our Navy is deployed, or you guys at, you know, conduct operations continually, in a sense you're out there, so we need to be attuned to what's happening there. It might be a sustainment problem, so we needed to work at that, or has been an incident or an accident, you know, like our patrol boat caught fire, you know, why did that happen? And we have to be ready there to understand those lessons. So it's a complex situation, but it has to be dynamically managed. I hope that addresses your issue.
Thank you so much, and good question there, Simon. Well done. Yes, over in the far corner.
Ma'am, good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Alex and Dr. Vega, thank you very much. As a gunnery officer, I have to say that I think one of the major challenges, however, is the undersea warfare space. And for us, one of the challenges has been dealing with force or theatre-level command and control. Mm-hmm. To you, Alex, what do you think would be those emerging technologies that would support us and support the bedrock concerns and issues associated with the future development of theatre-level command and control? What emerging technologies will assist us in better understanding that space? Thank you.
Tough question. Thank you.
You'll get tough ones for this audience.
That's very good. So, look, I think that at the theatre level, I think there's the reliance on communication technologies. And increasingly we are, I think, relying on SATCOM. You know, that is our kind of modus of our operations. I think that there's the reliance there may actually cause an issue for us ultimately. And I think we need to be thinking of other modes of communication. And as I sort of hinted in my talk, that radar technologies can actually now, it is a form of emission. And a phased array radar could actually carry communication for you. And you could actually construct ad hoc networks between platforms and actually start to operate that way. So I think we need to be thinking about constructing dynamic networks, which can be not static, and that reconfigure in real time and can sense, you know, so potentially a radar knows where something is, then it can actually send a direct message to that particular platform. And so ultimately, of course, your radar could be actually interfered with. So you may even think about, well, how can you use acoustic systems to potentially communicate? So, and what you'd want to do is ultimately a system which can switch between those modalities seamlessly, you know. And as platforms come in, they get automatically configured, become sensing who else is there, and be able to establish those protocols. Now, in theory, that is all possible, but that's a kind of like a vision or a pipe dream. But I think we have to aspire to things like this, and also be thinking, of course, of the red threat. How would people disrupt that? Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mike. Yes, sir.
Morning. My name is Shishir Upadhyay. I'm from ANCOS, and I have a question for Dr. Milan Vigo. Sir, at the end of the Second World War, there were some three or four countries who operated the aircraft carrier, namely USA, UK, Japan. I think Germany had one which they didn't really use. So overall, there were about over 100 aircraft carriers. And today, in the 21st century, we find that there are nearly 9 or 10 states which have aircraft carriers, although the number of total aircraft carriers is about 20. And they also talk of UAE and Saudi Arab being interested in buying an aircraft carrier. So what are your thoughts on how it's going to change naval warfare, you know, the acquisition of big platforms? Plus also there are LPDs which are capable of launching aircraft. Japan is operating such ships. Mm-hmm. So how do you think the induction of such big platforms with so many navies is going to change naval warfare?
Okay, thanks. You know, I think that's a good question. You know, certainly we have a much smaller number, but in terms of their, you know, combat potential, they're much certainly more effective. I think problems are in using Korea today in some areas, like South China Sea or Strait of Hormuz, for example, but not in all areas. And I'm not the one who say that carriers are not necessary. You know, the carriers, as long as you have a land-based manned aircraft, you will always need a sea, you know, platform too, you know. I think problem is with the, you know, again, we are, you know, there is always problem now and today, you know, to find a balance between efficiency and effectiveness. So we have a bigger carrier, 125,000 tons, for example, and I would argue that we probably need to distribute combat potential and having some smaller carriers which are actually more, you know, I think suitable for some other operations, short of the, you know, full-scale war, whatever, okay? And I think we also have certain lack of the balance in terms of nuclear power submarines and SSKs. I always argue you need both, you know, the only question of the proper balance, you know, that's a problem of the force planning, okay? I don't agree with it. In my remarks, I said, you know, that I think multi-mission ships are not why they are developed, because of the cost, you know, modern platforms are very costly, but also we sacrifice a lot of by having multi-mission versus dual-purpose ships, you know. When you talk about littoral warfare, for example, it makes no sense to have a large platforms operating both in open ocean and in littorals. I would argue that littorals, you need also combined arms approach, but having light frigates or multi-purpose corvettes, you know, SSKs, helicopters, mines, and so on, all integrated, but under the protection of the much higher things, okay? And I think that's what is the question of balancing. I think navies, especially big navies, needs to be balanced. That means you need to have an ability to operate properly across the spectrum. And, you know, any war, again, history is a great teacher, you know, any war we have, we always have a lack of smaller platforms. And our question today, whether you have time to build these small platforms if you lack them at the beginning of the war, okay? So that's a long answer to your question.
Thank you so much. And I'd like another question, please, from the floor. Perhaps one from some of our junior officers down the front. Oh, well done. Though not too junior.
Commander Carl Brinkman, my question is for Dr. Vigo. In your fine presentation, you talked about the over-exaggeration of technologies. You also talked about modular capabilities. For example, has the littoral combat ship maybe have come ahead of its time as those technologies are maybe not quite there, particularly in remote minefield sensing and similar type technologies? Is the ship kind of ahead of its time for technology?
No, I don't know. You know, again, you're asking a question I already wrote about that. I will repeat just, I think the LCS is, I'm sorry. The LCS is really a project which really, one difficulty was to apply commercial design. Again, I'm not a designer, but operator, you know, that applying commercial design to the naval platform, I think that's, in my view, not a good approach. And I think I'm more in favor of the Danish Stamflex, the method, where you have a same machinery and hull and sensor weapon, but then you alternate, you make a ship either predominantly anti-air or anti-surface or AW, and you combine this in the combat groups, you know, or various capabilities, you know, and instead of trying to have a single platform do all the things, you know, and at a short notice, you know. And I think, you know, when you have a platform of 2,800 tons, you know, despite the ability to operate in shallow water, it's not a really littoral platform. It is a blue water platform. And I think there was too much emphasis on speed. And I can tell you, I'm a long time, and I was torpedo boat commander, and I remember very well, we had a very small ability to sail with high speed, you know, for a long time. We will usually operate always from ambushes. So you only need the speed in order to avoid the you know, attacked by larger platform. But that, and I think today that will be not even possible to do it, you know. So I think too much power, everything, you know, is done, you know, to satisfy that requirements for high speed, you know. But again, I'm not a designer, I'm not an architect, I'm just a simple, you know, historian and a, you know, former operator of the smaller ships, you know. Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Carl. Now, one final question. Have we got one last question? Yes, down the front here. Thank you, Mr. Letts.
Thanks, Kath. Dr. Zelinsky, better get you back on the agenda. David Letts from ANU College of Law. Are there limits that you place on technological development? There are certain legal limits on deployment of weapon systems in armed conflict, but are there also moral, ethical limits that you and your organisation place on what you will and what you won't develop in terms of weapon systems, capabilities and so on?
Good question. But so in the end, our program is approved by the Department of Defence, and it's a program which I bring forward, and it is completely transparent and visible what we're doing. So I believe that our program complies with our policies, and we look at these things. And look, I think directed laser is one of those areas which is you know, a game changer. And we all know that you could use lasers to potentially blind people, but certainly we don't do that kind of work. And we sort of, there is a sort of, and that's a almost, you know, a non, well, it's not a treaty or anything at this stage, but a sense of coming forward. So we think about these things, and certainly in other areas like chemical biological threats, we have develop countermeasures. We have technologies which can actually detect if some sort of things like anthrax or other those things have been deployed, and so we can immediately protect, you know, our nation, our defence force. But we certainly don't, and we're not in the business of developing chemical or biological weapons. But you have to understand the threat so you can actually counter it. But so it's very much thinking about red threats.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to draw this session to a close. So could you please join me in thanking our guests today, Dr. Alex Zelinsky, our Chief Defence Scientist, and of course, Dr. Milan Vigo from the US Naval War College. Please join me in thanking our presenters.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes session 4. Please enjoy your lunch, and please return here for Transnational Threats, and be seated not later than 13:45.